You're at 241 Pearson Street, Ferndale, Michigan.
Sports Performance World to help you stay current and learn some cutting-edge new topics. I'm really excited. You can check it out on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen to your podcast by searching for the Sports Physical Therapy Podcast. Thanks so much. Now back to this episode. On this episode of the Ask Mike Reinold Show, we talk about using general medical screens in the orthopedic physical therapy setting.
The Ask Mike Reinold Show. Helping people feel better, move better, and perform better.
Before we get to the podcast, I wanted to make sure you knew about my free online course on the introduction to performance therapy and training. If you want to learn how to get started optimizing and enhancing performance, this is the course for you. Head to MikeReynolds.com/performance. Missing something that turned out to be non-musculoskeletal. I definitely have some stories too, and I think we have some decent advice, but like, I don't know, why don't we start with this, right? I mean, so we're outpatient orthopedic, you know, you could argue we're probably high-end orthopedic slash sports. Most physical therapy clinics in the world have sports in their name. You drive by and there's no athletes anywhere near them, right? So most people aren't sports. We're probably, what would you guys say, 80% sports? You know, meaning like an actual athlete that plays on a sport with a team, you know, like, so we're like 80% sport. So, I don't know. I feel like most of our people come to us with very specific things. That doesn't mean that they have some underlying things we have, but, who wants to start? I mean, anybody have some stories? Maybe we'll start by like sharing some stories. So that way we can do that experience. You know, talk about the experience. So Dave, you said you had one.
Yeah, I'll say one thing else more too, because I think that there is still, obviously not medical, a bunch of different systems, but there's still a lot of red flags that we have to look out for as sports, right? Like ruling out a stress fracture or ruling out something that's a little more serious in nature, and I think that is important to remember if you're running sports, that it's not all casual. But yeah, the best experience that I had was I evaluated someone with neck pain, and just the story was not making great sense of how they kind of got rushed through. They were either in the ER or they kind of got a consult. It was very quick. They got rushed by somebody who looked at them and said like, oh yeah, general neck pain, here's some muscle relaxers, and then I'll see you, you know back in 6 weeks after your 500 misses of PT. And the person was a little bit older and had some symptoms that were overlapping with dizziness, and so it was hard. And I was with a student, and she was just during her evaluation, she turned her head to one side, and she was like, oh, that kind of makes it hard to see. And I was like, what? She was like, yeah, I turned my head like this, and things get really fuzzy, like on this side, like it's dizzy, it gets fuzzy. And I was like, wait a minute. And it turned out she was having some DBA. So sent her back, and the same doctor was like a little dumbfounded. I missed this, and I was like, I can think of a few ways, maybe it's just a little rushed, but
yeah,
it'll probably time. Yeah, it was like snapping fingers. It went from like very musculoskeletal, like, okay, like, yeah, looking, maybe turning, maybe like some ear stuff or whatever, maybe like dizziness. But like when she started saying her vision was going to like stop everything. And we're all set for this. We didn't tell her. We were like, no, it's like a half hour inbound. We were like, no, we're not going to leave. We're going to get you back to 6 minutes. She went directly to the ER with her sister, maybe, and we got her up.
Nice. Anybody else?
Well, I know you guys have some good stories.
Yeah, I mean, I've had stuff where you find like a AAA, like a low back pain. That's like an aneurysm or something like that. I know when I was in North Carolina, at a practice, we had a client that had that, kind of saved that person's life. But I think maybe it just came out of JOSPT. I think it's this month, looking at some red flags that you have to keep in mind when someone presents with low back pain. So those are really good. Able to kind of throw in your back pocket and just have it in your head, because it talks about, you know, some questions you should probably ask the person about their recent history that they probably wouldn't think is significant for their back pain. And then when you start asking and they start answering positively, you really need to set some bells and whistles up in your head. You know, like having some kind of fever or sweats or some of the typical things that we kind of ignore as PT sometimes. And we just kind of focus on the musculoskeletal system because we just think everybody has a low back strain or a herniated disc in their back. We just kind of dive into that. And if you don't ask the question, they don't know how to share that. That's one of the things that really kind of evolved in my career, is now trying to really dive into the subjective and the history, because I think that's going to be the most important thing, is asking the right question. People don't know what to tell you. They just, they have to face their back pain. They control their back pain. X-ray was negative. So here we go. So I think that paper, JOSPT, was a nice little paper to kind of summarize some of the red flags that we often see. But, you know, DVTs, finding DVTs in people, especially post-op people, when it looks like a calf pain, and you start questioning stuff. And I'm trying to think of anything else, because we had a baseball player that had thoracic pain. We treated for a shoulder issue. In fact, the thoracic pain just didn't make sense. And we were treating it. We're like, this, their pain is getting worse. This doesn't seem musculoskeletal. It turned out he had a benign tumor in his spine. So, I think it's, if it doesn't fit your typical presentation, it really makes you think, and you're really racking your brain to try to figure out what is going on, I would just refer back and get imaging or get something, get another set of eyes on it. If it doesn't make sense, usually it's something most of it.
Lots of good info. I wanted to add a little piece to what Lenny said, just because he said the aneurysm thing, the AAA. Do we say AAA or AAA? What do we say? Yes, a triple A. Is it triple A?
Well, you guys think
triple A.
I know, that's why I said triple A.
I think I have a flat tire on the highway, but.
So, somebody on Twitter posted this a while ago, and I took a picture of it. I've been meaning to write one of my weekly newsletters about this, but here's the exact tweet or Instagram or whatever this was. But I had a case recently in which I evaluated an 85-year-old female with lower thoracic pain. She has a history of compression fractures. All the time with her previous physical therapist, they worked on general range of motion, pain science, trying to get her to cope with her pain, okay, without much help. After digging in, I referred out, and she had an aneurysm. So she had, the AAA, so abdominal aortic aneurysm, right? And you're doing pain science with this person because she has chronic low back pain. Holy smokes, right? That tells me right there, like, their therapist wasn't, you know, A, probably wasn't asking the right questions, B, wasn't thinking enough, and C, being a little righteous, thinking like, wow, you know, chronic low back pain, it's all pain signs, where, apparently aneurysms hurt. I didn't know that, right? But, aneurysms are frowned upon. But you can see where, I think, more, not just to just dig on the whole concept of pain science with that, but more the concept of like being stuck in one treatment paradigm, right? If that is, if you only have like one thought process and everybody is like chronic pain, you're going to miss some things. So, and we can say that about anything. So how about you guys, Lisa, Dan, you guys had any experience with this stuff?
I think it's super important. To be honest, I moved from a population that was less healthy to a population that's more healthy. So I probably do a little less screening than I used to. I've referred a few people to an emergency room. One person was having dizziness and diplopia. They said they're having drop attacks, and they got faint when I was needling one time. Like, you need to go to the emergency room. And it was actually fine. And I had another gentleman who had a hip scope labor repair, and sent him to the emergency room because he was having some symptoms that I thought were potentially DVT. And turns out it was, and I've said a few other people where there was nothing in general, but I really agree with what you guys have to say. First and foremost, you kind of have to know what the red flags are, and it does change a little bit based on the area, but I mean, you know, red flags still exist for a shoulder problem, right? I mean, I think people always think of like, all right, low back pain, that could be a whole bunch of problems, right? They're sinister, but you can set the same thing for the knee and the same thing for the shoulder. So you always have to have your eye open for that. And if it's just not progressing the way it normally does, then refer out. Because I think right now in the blogosphere, I keep calling the blogosphere, which is probably like 10 years ago, the social
media. That term.
Yeah.
That's pretty good. I mean, that's your niche.
That's my niche. I like blogosphere. And I think for good reason, we're kind of anti-imaging right now. But the other part is like, we don't want to miss things, right? I mean, you got to make sure you do what's appropriate for the person that's in front of you, right? I don't know if you're going to...
Can I just jump in and say, like, we're not all anti-imaging?
Yeah.
Right?
The blogosphere is the...
Depends on which niche you're in.
Yeah.
If you're a niche person or a niche person, depends on what you're...
depends on the key like, thing to do.
Yeah.
You sure have that.
But I think that same thing goes back to my story. It's your personal beliefs that you're anti-imaging that you're going to probably dig your heels in a little bit and delay. That could be a problem within somebody's life. So, I don't know. Anything else, Dan?
All right. Lucy, go first, and then I have one more thing to chime in. That's
take turns, Tilly. Let's go.
I'm allowing her.
Just kidding. Dan, I didn't mean to cut you off. Sorry.
That's all right. All good. No, I just, you know, do your due diligence, right? We have guidelines for even like meniscus tears. Like if you think it's a meniscus, it might be something else. You get an x-ray first and then you treat it, right? You don't just assume blindly.
I think that's great. Lisa, have you been lucky or have you had to have any experiences yet?
Luckily, I haven't had to like send someone to the ER straight
from PT. That's good.
I mean, I definitely, you know, I've worked in settings where there are kind of not as healthy population, and I think, you know, I was on my guard a lot more to, and I guess what it taught me was that I needed to ask a lot of questions and not just assume that I was, like, immediately going to musculoskeletal something, you know, and to, like, really confirm that everything felt good and it seemed to fit the picture, and you know, to encourage someone to at least, like, ask questions of their doctor or find some more information or that kind of a thing before we, like, press on into anything really significant. But, I mean, yeah, I've been lucky that I don't have to send someone out.
That's good. Now you're preparing.
Yeah.
This is amazing. Dave, what else do you think you have?
Yeah, I probably should start the story, but I remember a previous patient that I worked with, that she had like a labral tear, very like hypermobile. She was doing crossfit, things like that. She had a hip scope and got it repaired. It was good. But then the other side also, you know, started to have issues too. And the surgeon I was working with, super high level, really good doc, we both were just like, man, this doesn't make sense. She started having like weird generalized multi joint pain. And so one time she got a fever or something of that nature and went to the hospital and got, I forget what lab test she got done, but I remember calling my friend who's an emergency room physician's assistant. And I was like, man, this doesn't make sense. Like, what would you say if you saw these numbers? He was like, oh, high risk of bone cancer. And I was like, what? And he was like, oh yeah, for sure. Clinical patterns. I never followed up with her because she continued on her own way with that medical path. But it just really struck me as like two different perspectives of the same. You know, I was looking at like only ortho, hip scope, CrossFit, squatting, whatever. And he was like, yeah, that's a really high risk.
I like it. So you know, the general theme that everybody said here, this is how I educate our students. So I say this, you know, when you have a scratch your head moment, right? So when you're trying to put pieces of the puzzle together, you end up concluding that the puzzle doesn't fit nicely together, and we're missing something, right? That doesn't mean we're missing something sinister, like we've kind of talked about here, or even just general medical. You could be missing something orthopedically, like musculoskeletal, but oftentimes it's a sign that we're missing something. So we either need to dig in deeper with our subjective, dig in deeper with our objective, right, to try to get this out, or refer them away, better safe than sorry. I think that's the challenge. Especially now, as our profession gets more and more direct access, you better be ready for this, right? You certainly, you know, don't do that. So I would say the big summaries, right, is, you know, like, don't have a closed mindset. mindset about some of your beliefs here when people come in with certain symptoms and pains and complaints, right? Or you're gonna have tunnel vision and kind of put them in one basket, right? So kind of have an open mind. But when things don't start adding up, ask more questions, figure out where we are and see if we need to refer out. So that was a good one. I think that's gonna be real helpful for people. Like, no one's an expert at this, right? You just have to be an expert at having a good hunch, right? And Dave gave some experience and some things like early on in his career that I think a lot of like young therapists could probably benefit from. You know, if you don't have 20 years of experience that you can go back and see like your head with, then ask some friends, reach out, get your coworkers, be like, hey, this doesn't add up to me. Does this add up to you? Am I missing something? And see what they say too. Because remember, it's for the benefit of the person in front of you. So awesome. Great question. Thank you so much. Another great episode. Head to MikeRinaldo.com, click on that podcast link and fill out the form to ask some more questions. And please head to iTunes, Spotify. I want to see more reviews. We haven't got a review in a while, I think. I don't know. I actually haven't looked, but I want to see more reviews. We read the reviews. We kind of jump in there every now and then for feedback because we want to make this better. So hopefully you guys are enjoying this and staying from home just like us. And we will see you on the next episode.
Before we get to this episode, I wanted to make sure you knew about my brand new show, the Sports Physical Therapy Podcast. I'll be interviewing a bunch of amazing guests in sports medicine and sports performance world to help you stay current and learn some cutting edge new topics. I'm really excited. You can check it out on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you listen to your podcast by searching for the Sports Physical Therapy Podcast. Thanks so much. Now back to this episode.
On this episode of the Ask Mike Reinold Show, we talk about restoring hyperextension after knee surgery.
The Ask Mike Reinold Show. Helping people feel better. Move better. Perform better.
Before we get to the podcast, I wanted to make sure you knew about my free online course on the introduction to performance therapy and training. If you want to learn how to get started optimizing and enhancing performance, this is the course for you. Head to MikeReynolds.com/performance to sign up today. Welcome back, everybody, to the latest episode of the Ask Mike Reynolds Show. I am joined by Lisa Russell, Lenny Macrina, Dave Tilling, Dan Pope. I'm trying to mix it up as always. Here answering your amazing questions. So again, we're at home, still not really at full go at GMVPT Performance up in Boston, but we're still here answering your questions. If you had anything, go to MikeRinaldo.com, click on that podcast link, and you can fill out the form to ask us questions like this. So today, I think we got an easy one here. I don't think Lenny's going to rant on this one, but I think we got an easy one.
Let's see.
Oh boy.
I think the niche question here is going to be very niche, but let's see here. I'm going to see how much
time we're working. I'm known for rants.
I don't think this is rantable. But let's see. Lynn from Arkansas asks, what should the goal be for knee extension post knee surgery when the contralateral knee has excessive hyperextension? You know, I think it's a good question. I feel like Lenny and I's opinions, I don't want to say change because that seems wrong. I think they've evolved slightly over the years from where we've done. But Len, why don't you answer this from your perspective as like what you currently recommend and maybe some of the past thoughts on that too? Because I think a lot of people have learned something in the past and then just go right back to what they were doing 10 years ago without thinking about some new stuff. So yeah. What's your current thought process on this?
Without knowing what excessive hyperextension means in the question, I'm going to assume it's like that excessive, like 10, 15 degrees of hyperextension, which is a lot for some people. But hyperextension is normal. It's if you measure people's knees, they're going to probably have 4 to 6 degrees easily of hyperextension. So the excessive person, 10 to 15 degrees, I would say maybe 10, 15, 20 years ago, we would say, maybe that's why you tore your ACL. Let's just get to zero, and you'll be fine. And then we got some research that had come out that showed that those people long-term don't do as well. So they have anterior knee pain. They may get some arthritis in the front of their knee, like the telfemoral joint. They just never get back to their sport because they always have irritation in the knee. So a couple studies that I always go back to by Don Shelbourne out of Indianapolis showed that the ligament has no extra laxity on it if you gain hyperextension back, meaning similar to the other side for that person, and their function improves. Like they feel better about their knee.